There's so much to say about this album, but it basically comes down to this, the idea that 50 years after John Coltrane's passing, his influence and his impact on improvisational music today is heavier than ever.
I received a phone call from BBC, Robert Abel, and he said, can you put together something for Coltrane? I called everybody, and within a few days I had everybody, but of course Cecil McVie, who's a regular bassist, couldn't make it, so Ron McClure made it.
His vocabulary is as much quoted today as any other tradition in improvisational music. The challenge is to somehow find room for one's individual voice.
Well, John Coltrane, for me, has always been one of the most amazing, creative, incredible improvisers in the world of music. I grew up around Cleveland, Ohio, and my dad was one of the leading saxophonists around town. My dad heard him live and played at a jam session with him in the early 50s. Through the years, I just grew up listening to all of the different periods, and I heard it all as one.
There was a significance in Coltrane that we all are aware of now, which I felt the first time I saw him, which was at Birdland in 1962. And there was, in the placard outside Birdland, it was the Bill Evans Trio and John Coltrane Quintet, and there was a picture of him on soprano. And this group comes on, and they start playing. This guy sounds like he's practicing. It sounds like me at home. Now, of course, we wasn't practicing, obviously. But what I think I saw was there's a lot more than meets the eye.
It was 1956 when I first heard John Coltrane on a record called Blue Train. I had been playing with a band called the Kingsmen, a local New Haven band. A young man named Tommy Brazil came and sat in with us, and he had a sound similar to Coltrane, Johnny Griffin at that time. I had to know what he listened to, and so he said, you have to get Blue Train, which literally changed my life.
John Coltrane, for somebody almost more than the man himself, it's like a concept. He was like a spiritual leader. And for certain musicians like me, he stood for fair play. Like he had done a conference one time and they asked him what he was trying to do with his music. And he said, I simply want to be a force for good.
What's amazing about Compassion is that with Dave Liebman and Joe Lovano in charge, two of the most identifiable, immediately recognizable voices on saxophone today, I believe they found that balance of paying tribute to the master and yet find a way of maintaining who they are and pushing that forward as well.
Dave Love mentioned to me that Dave Liebman had a very interesting recording that he had been holding on to. And you know, at Resonance, we know a thing or two about releasing archival recordings. This really fit in line with our mission and what we're doing. It was a good fit for us at this label because we love John Coltrane, but I have to admit, we also love Dave Liebman, Joe Lovano, and the bandmates on this recording.
We try to cover the emotional feelings, the energy, and the idea of playing in a congregation as a quintet.
I'm pretty sure Joe brought it or said, let's do Locomotion, because it wasn't a tune I played. Did the ballad things with him doing Central Park West, that was his call, of course. I love Dear Lord. I think Dear Lord is one of the most amazing compositions in the world because it is so diatonic and perfect. Ole was another piece that would represent Train, his interest in world music. Compassion, of course, comes from the Meditation Suite. And Equinox is, of course, one of the blues from the, you know, Atlantic period with Train. But the find there is Reverend King, which I don't remember how I found it or how I got it. But that was a revelation that he had written this tune for Dr. King. Joe's come to New York from Cleveland, been around since the 70s, you know, he used to come with Elvin, hang out, sit in, you know. And Joe's a beautiful cat, he's very easy to work with a complete understanding of the music and of the lifestyle and of what makes this music what it is. Phil Markowitz, I had known Phil through his playing with Chet Baker and with Mel and Thad, you know, and I knew he was a fine piano player. Ron McClure was with me in my band I had with John Scofield in the late 70s, and he was in Quest with Virac and Billy Hart. Of course, Billy Hart with Quest, I mean, he's, you know, that's the guy.
You know, the spiritualness in John Coltrane's music comes through in the collaborations and the congregations of players feeding off each other. Development of ideas as a group, those spiritual moments happen.
When you play a repertoire like Coltrane, being from the same generation helps because you all have the same understandings. And you were all affected similarly in the same period. Nothing like guys that have an understanding when you had your understanding.
Coltrane is still my major reason for playing this music. I mean, he's my major inspiration, no doubt in my mind.
The stories about him practicing are legendary. Reggie Workman told me, he says, listen, if John didn't have the saxophone around his neck, he was sleeping.
We have a lot to learn from in terms of John Coltrane's music and what this music speaks to. On behalf of everyone at Resonance Records, we're very thrilled and honored to work to officially release this music.